talk by J. Krishnamurti is on the topic being vulnerable to truth. Now, if you try to understand the meaning of vulnerability, vulnerability refers to the
Krishnamurti.
Yeah.
Krishnamurti, I'm sorry, your bandwidth seems to be low. So no. Can you actually knock off the video?
Knock off the video?
Because then it will, at least the audio will come out very clear then.
Okay.
Till your power kind of comes back.
This audio is okay now?
Yes, this is much better. Yeah.
Audio is okay?
Yes. We can hear you now. Yeah.
Right. So, when we are talking about this vulnerability, it is that quality of being exposed to the possibility of being harmed. Somebody is vulnerable in the sense he is in a position where he can be either physically or mentally or emotionally, somebody can cause harm to him. But here in the context of what Jiddu Krishnamurti is discussing, it's more a case of being sensitive, being in a state where one is exposing himself or herself to that truth or that dimension where it would directly impact on that person. Now, in another context also, Krishnamurti uses this term vulnerability. He says, can you see how vulnerable a flower is? That means some kind of a strong wind or anybody can simply pluck it off. Even a child can and all the petals and everything and scatter them. That means it is so delicate and so sensitive and exposing itself to the danger of being destroyed. But the quality of the flower is also such that it does not consider any of these things and simply blossoms. Imagine a flower thinking to itself that no, if I blossom or if I bloom, somebody is going to pluck me, somebody is going to crush me, or somebody is going to extract the fragrance out of me, or simply pull off the petals and destroy me. If the flower were to think in those terms, it would never blossom at all. So he talks about that kind of sensitivity and vulnerability, because unless you are in that state, you cannot actually experience what is termed as the truth. So he is talking from that dimension, where he is talking about a person being vulnerable to truth. Now, this talk was given on 1st of July 1934. And what struck me very strange is that he begins this talk by saying, I think most people have lost the art of listening. Way back in 1934, he is saying that when the whole of humanity did not have so many distractions as we have today. So imagine the plight of the humanity today or people today with these kind of distractions and disturbances. We have actually lost most of our sensitivity and our ability to listen, or the art of listening. So in fact, we have gone from bad to worse, actually, in a way, when you see the context in which he was talking in 1934. Now, can you give me 1 minute? Can you just give me 1 minute? I think my connectivity is. I'll just get back to you in a minute.
Sure. Yeah. Yes. Go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, are you able to see me now?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, and hear me also clearly, because this is now on the Wi-Fi internet.
Yes, perfect. Yes.
So you see, the point he's trying to make is that we somehow seem to have lost our ability or the art of listening, which is very, very important, because we do not listen only with our ears. We listen with our whole being. And if we are attentive to this process of listening, there is a different dimension to the whole process, where listening and the combined listening of all the senses would be there together. At the very beginning of the talk itself, he makes one more thing clear, that please do not try to seek through these talks a solution for your particular problems or any alleviation of your suffering. You see, this is not a therapy program or some kind of a treatment being given, and the listener is coming for finding a solution for his own particular problems or suffering. What is important is, he says, regard life not as several isolated problems, but comprehensively as a whole, with a mind that is not suffocated by the search for solutions. The search for solutions is a great hindrance for the mind. It gets flustered, it gets suffocated, it feels as though it is being constrained, because it is trying to orient itself towards a particular solution. But we are not talking about a particular solution to a particular problem. What he says is, we need to look at life very comprehensively and not as isolated incidents or events. You have to perceive the whole of life in the totality of that context, because otherwise the mind will only try to focus on its own problems and its own suffering. Now, he comes back with a very important aspect after this particular statement. After this particular statement, he says, now each one more or less is consumed by desires whose objects vary according to environment, temperament, and inheritance. Let us dwell for some time on these three words: environment, temperament, and inheritance. Now, you see, all of us are some way or the other consumed by desires, whether gross or subtle, direct or indirect, conscious or unconscious, very open or hidden. Whatever be the nature of it, we are actually consumed by all sorts of desires. But these desires vary according to three factors. Being consumed by desires is a common factor, but the nature of the desire or the objects for which there is a desire varies according to the environment. Environment in the sense, your surroundings. You can say your community, your region, your area, your nation, or your own family, and the background of that family, All this forms the environment. Obviously, earlier we have seen in one of his talks that the I, which we identify ourselves as, is a product of the environment, is a result of the environment. Because we exchange experiences, knowledge, and store it in our memory based on the kind of exposure we have to the environment. So that is one aspect of it. Your desire is conditioned by the environment in which you are born. And your temperament is something again individual. At least in my opinion, after comprehensively studying Krishnamurti, he is averse to using terms such as your past karma or your vasanas or samskaras and all. He doesn't want to use any of these traditional words. But temperament really means that. Your temperament actually really means the software, the baggage with which you have come. The baggage with which one has come about into being in this world. That is your temperament. Now, apart from this temperament, he also talks that there is something called as a collective consciousness of the humanity, which has evolved over several millennia. And that he calls it as the racial inheritance. The racial inheritance is there are certain things which have, right from the day the human being, as we understand, or Homo sapiens was born, there is an accumulation of all the experiences of humanity as a whole. This is what we have inherited. And therefore, he calls it as inheritance. And there are a lot of scientific studies which have been done, which very clearly show that unknowingly we acquire so many things from the whole race of the human race. Some very interesting studies were conducted with chimpanzees and monkeys. There were a lot of these plantain or banana trees alongside a beach. And when these were, fruits were falling down, obviously they fall into the mud or the sand, and therefore over a period of time, these chimpanzees have learned to wash these bananas to clear the sand and all, and then eat it. Now they have found that after two or three generations, the third generation monkey would automatically wash the banana even though there is no sand around there. You understand what I'm saying? See, it got into the genes of those monkeys because the father monkey was washing, the grandfather monkey was washing, and the great-grandfather monkey, the chimpanzee, was washing. So the washing became a kind of a genetic factor irrespective of the purpose for which it was started with. So this is what he calls as racial inheritance. This is what the collective humanity inherits. And in scientific terms, they call it as the reptile brain or the limbic brain, which has the memory of thousands and thousands of years of evolution. So essentially, please try to understand these three terms: environment, temperament, and inheritance. These are the three factors. Inheritance conditions the whole of humanity. Environment conditions to the extent a person is surrounded by a certain kind of environment. And the temperament is what he brings in with him. Brings along with him when a person is born, the latent talents or predilections or propensities or weaknesses or strengths or whatever you call them. Generally, the terms that are traditionally used are samskaras and vasanas and all that. Let's not get into that mode. But look at these three factors as the factors which condition a human being. And the nature of desire, the objects vary, but the essential factor of all of us being consumed by some form of the desire remains. So according to your particular conditioning, to your particular education and upbringing and religious or social and economic conditions, you have established a certain objectives. Each one establishes a certain set of objectives, a set of objectives which are based on this particular conditioning, education, upbringing, the religious, social and economic conditions in which a person is. So all these things establish the nature of objectives whose attainment you are endlessly pursuing. And this pursuit has become paramount in your lives. So what has happened now? We have this desire, and we have the types of desires or the objects of desires which are based on the environment, temperament and inheritance, and also on the religious, social and economic conditions, and also on the education and upbringing of a person. Now, having got into this mode, we are endlessly pursuing, and this pursuit becomes the most important thing in our life. The pursuit. Because you see, right from the beginning, if we go back to our childhood and schooling and all, we have been told that man should have certain goals, objects, aims, purpose, high ideals. We have been, drilled into you. Certain things have been drilled into us that one has to have goals, one has to have objects, one has to have some driving force to achieve something, to attain something. And this becomes an endless pursuit. There is no end to this. So now what has become important? The pursuit of objects has become the most important thing. Now, do we see the fallacy of this? Do we see the fallacy of the whole damn thing? That is important. What is important is to see that we have been conditioned in this manner. Now, nobody is criticizing or condemning or justifying or doing anything. But do we see that this conditioning is there? We will come to the aspect of whether it is a hurdle or obstacle or hindrance or not, or whether this itself is a big issue for us. We'll come to it later, but we should be acutely aware of the fact that this particular conditioning is what exists. This is what we are. We are bound by these things. Certain types of objectives, which are driven by our desires. And the desire is to attain something, to gain something, to achieve something, to reach some point. So this conditioning we should be acutely aware of. Now, the moment one has established these objectives and the pursuit of that, those objectives becomes paramount or most important thing in one's life. Obviously, all of us have also experienced the fact that our desires are not fulfilled. Fulfilled in the sense, these desires reach a certain point and then they get modified, they get changed. You hang on to or you get on to another form of desire, another kind of desire, and then you go on endlessly pursuing them. So there is always a gap between what the state in which you are and the state you want to attain, the state you want to reach, whether physical or emotional or mental or social or financial or whatever it is. I am in a particular state and I am disturbed by this state because I have certain objectives and I am not able to achieve those objectives. So what do? I try to find ways and means of fulfilling or, you know, getting into attaining these desires. Now, very, very interestingly, way back in 1934 itself, Krishnamurti has discovered a very beautiful thing which he presents to us and says that once you have established these objectives, there naturally arise the specialists. Mark this term, but specialists. There naturally arise the specialists who act as your guides towards the attainment of your desires. Mark this word specialist very carefully. The specialist could be a psychiatrist, a psychologist, a counselor, a teacher, a guru, a spiritual master, depending on the nature of your desire. So there is always somebody out there who is more than eager to guide you and say, please come to me, I will tell you how to fulfill your desires. Don't we see hundreds and thousands of books on how to attain, how to reach, how to be happy, how to become a better leader or a great orator, or you can win, you don't win, or you can do that, you can do this, you can become something, and your desire to attain happiness or God or realization or liberation or nirvana or moksha, there is a specialist out there. Because you have defined a desire, you have created a market for all those specialists. You see the beauty of it now. You are not willing to depend on yourself to fulfill your desires because you find that you don't have that capability to fulfill your own desires. Your desires appear to be bizarre or weird or something which you can't really talk to people also. Then what do you do? Then you go to a psychiatrist and tell him that I have all kinds of these desires, what should I do? Then he will give you some counseling, or he'll tell you that it's not wrong to have these desires. Many people have these desires. So it's okay for you. So he'll give you some level of comfort, and he'll create a situation because you have created the market for such people. Whether they are godmen, whether they are spiritual gurus, whether they are scientific gurus, or whether they are technical gurus, whether they are psychiatrists or psychologists or whomsoever you call it as, this very establishment of objectives and the pursuit of those objectives has brought forth naturally all these specialists. Do we see the significance of this? This is very, very important. This is very, very important because the mind always tries to escape from the what is, from the reality of what is, because it has created the ideal. It has created the ideal and put that ideal on a pedestal. We have put the ideal on a high point. And you assume that you are at a very low point and you have to make a lot of effort to reach that point. That's why Krishnaji always says, non-violence is also a form of violence. Because non-violence is not a truth, it is only an ideal. The truth is violence. The creation of an ideal called as non-violence is not really going to help you. Because you are not confronting the what is, the present, the thing as it stands today. And because you are going out in search of people who will fulfill your desires, who will give you that satisfaction, you have created the market. And as the law of market says, wherever somebody or the other will fill that vacuum. If all of us have the desire or a need for a certain thing, there'll be a technologist or an engineer who will create that product for you because you wanted it. So you see the very nature of the desires, the very nature of the objects, and the pursuit of those objectives endlessly. And that has created the further complication of bringing about all the specialists on whom we start relying. We are not talking about specialists in certain specific areas. Like, for example, you have a toothache. Obviously, there is a need for a dentist. We are not talking about that. You have a gastroenterology problem. You go to a gastroenterologist. So, Krishnamurti is not talking about that kind of specialists who are very much required, but look at the specialists on whom we psychologically depend. We depend psychologically on these specialists because there is something insufficient in me, something lacking in me, something that is creating disturbance in me. Nature of the desire, nature of the objective is of no concern because each one has got his own types of desire, nature, the objectives, everything differs from person to person. But the ground of all these things is that all of us commonly are consumed by desires and we set up our own objectives and goals and aims and things like that and pursue those things. Now, he says, you are concerned with the attainment of an objective, not with the fulfillment of intelligence, which is action. So life becomes a school of great conflict and struggle, never a thing of fulfillment, of richness, of completeness. Now here he brings in the word called intelligence. Now intelligence is, according to Krishnaji, the very acute awareness of what is without the interference of the mind. Again, at the cost of repeating, I'm just trying to bring forth the point that the mind is always the past. Mind is an accumulation of experiences, knowledge, and memory. So, when the mind is in operation, we should be able to clearly understand that it is the past which is operating. And the past is always known. The past can never bring forth anything new. Therefore, it is important to see the fallacy of allowing the mind to interfere in this process. So, a state of being which is total awareness of what is without the interference of the mind is what Krishnaji calls as intelligence. So, when this intelligence operates, there is fulfillment, and that intelligence itself is action. A new dimension of action comes into being where accumulated past is not acting, but that intelligence is acting. I hope I am clear. I hope we are together in this. If there is anything, you can put a, you know, in the chat, you can just put a message. If you are, if things are not very clear and if you want further, you know, elaboration or clarity on certain points, because as we move forward, if things are not clear at this stage, they may appear to complicate things as we go further. So let us be very clear about what we are talking. What we are talking is about this nature of desire, that we are all consumed by these desires and that we are stuck in it, and depending upon the environment into which we are born, depending upon the temperament which we have, and depending upon the racial inheritance of the human being itself at a large scale, our objectives of desire are decided, and the pursuit of those desires becomes the most important aspect of our lives. This has given birth to specialists. The specialist can be anybody. As I said, it can be a psychiatrist, a psychologist, a counselor, or a godman, or a spiritual teacher, or a guru, or whomsoever you call him as. That is the nature of the specialist. And he will come forth and give you some advice or the other. Here, we are only concerned with the attainment of objective. But if we were to be if we were to be seriously concerned about the fulfillment of intelligence, which is action. Intelligence is the acute awareness of what is, without the interference of the past, which we are calling as the mind. So life becomes a school of great conflict and struggle. When we do not allow that intelligence to operate, life becomes a great conflict and struggle. He says a school of great conflict and struggle, and never a thing of fulfillment. Fulfillment can be there only in intelligence. Richness and completeness of life can also be there only in that intelligence. And we can never experience that in the great conflict and struggle in which we are stuck. So he says, goes on to say that you are concerned with the purpose, with the end, rather than the living in the present. Our whole focus is on the purpose, is on the ideal, is on the end, which is outside and beyond us. But ironically, this particular what we call as the nature of things that are happening, or the ideals or goals which we are setting up, are nothing but a projection of the past. Projection of the past. Okay. So this projection of the past is what we are calling is the future. But the future need not necessarily be what you are thinking. The future could be something totally different, which we are not aware of. If you are aware of it, the future becomes the past. So our concern is with the purpose and the end, rather than living in the present. Whereas he says, a man who fulfills never inquires into the end, because fulfillment itself is sufficient. There is no need for an end. See, if you are happy with the present, why do you need an objective? Why need a goal or an aim? The fact that you have established a goal or an objective out there and consider it to be somewhere beyond you and in the future, that itself is an indication that you are not happy. This is precisely this happiness or a kind of fulfillment through innocence is what we see in children. What we see in children, unfortunately, I would say before they actually go to school. The moment you put them in school, they are lost. You put them into the world which they don't understand. So as tiny tots, as children who are not yet exposed to the world, they are happy in the situation in which they are innocently. So Similarly, a person who finds fulfillment in the present, he need not have or even inquire about the end or a purpose or an objective or a goal or an aim or an attainment or an achievement at all. Right? So he says such a person, for him the fulfillment itself is sufficient. Now we have an interesting question. I would like to answer this question before I proceed further. Commander Ramji has put an interesting question, and he says, like a doctor helps to cure the body, a godman helps to bring peace to self. So what is wrong? Now, sir, what is wrong in this thing is, you are forgetting the fact that you do not understand what is the self in the first place. What you and I call as the self is a creation of the environment, is a conditioned response to the whole situation, which is a bundle of experience, knowledge, and memory. That is the self. And this particular self has created its own set of desires. Now, the fact of the matter is, do we question the nature of the desire in the first place? Let us forget about peace and other things. The desire is the one which is prompting you to create an objective, to create an ideal, number one. This desire is the one thing that is creating the conflict and the struggle and the suffering and the sorrow.
Yes.
That has to, you have to be aware of that fact first.
Okay.
There is a difference between a toothache and a conflict in the mind because of the desire. A doctor, if he finds that a particular tooth is, there's a cavity or there is an infection, yes, he can simply remove that tooth and relieve you of that pain and that infection.
Yes, sir.
But you tell me, who in this world can remove that trouble caused by the desire and the conflict and the struggle going on you, just as a dentist extracts a tooth? Can you find somebody like that?
No, one has to do oneself.
But that is precisely what I am saying. So, you are pursuing a godman is as foolish as you are pursuing somebody to take away something from your mind,
yes, sir,
thinking that it is objective, like the tooth, aching tooth.
Yes, sir, I understand the difference.
So that is the point he is trying to make. Because you couldn't find out a means of understanding the very nature of the desire, the nature of the objectives and the conflict and struggle the desires and objectives create in you, you are avoiding that question and going and trying to find a means from somebody outside yourself. The moment you come to somebody, that somebody will say that I am a specialist in this subject, and then he will give you some idiotic solution. But is it solving your problem once for all? Is it solving your problem once for all? No.
Yes.
It may temporarily solve your problem, but next day you are back with another problem.
Yes.
Then the next day there is another problem.
Yes, sir.
So you see, this is a continuous thing. It's an endless pursuit. That's why Krishnaji says this is an endless pursuit.
Got it, sir.
So what one has to become is, can you please mute the, yeah, thank you. So you see the problem now? So if one becomes aware of what is, without the interference of the past, which we call as the mind, then there is a possibility of something new happening. That Krishnaji refers to as the intelligence. And that intelligence itself is action. That means what flows from that intelligence is the right action. You need not bring about any change. The idea of bringing about a change is also an activity of the mind. It is the mind which is thinking that I am in this situation and I need to change it. But there is no, see that when the activity of the mind is not there, there is no desire for change also. You're not looking for change. You are looking at the problem as it is with all your energy and all your awareness, with all your attention. And as I said, attention is all inclusive. Whereas focus or concentration is exclusive. You have to understand the meaning of these two terms in which they are used. Attention refers to a state of being which is all inclusive. That means all your senses are functioning. All your faculties are functioning. And you have brought in that awareness to what is. Now, the problem here is, this has to be at the background always for us. The moment we become inattentive, it will fall into some kind of conflict. The mind will again start thinking in terms of pursuing something, achieving something, attaining something. Nobody is again questioning that the pursuit or the attainment or the achievement has got any problem in it. The problem is how you perceive the whole thing. You got to do a certain work, you got to do it. You have got to do a certain work. You are given a responsibility of certain action and you have taken a responsibility to perform certain things. Obviously, nobody is asking you to become irresponsible. Please do not understand that all desires are bad, all action is bad, all objectives are bad. No. What is important is to perceive the nature of desires, the nature of objectives, the nature of ideals we have created, the nature of insufficiency in which we are struggling and creating sorrow and suffering for ourselves. When you have a certain functioning to do, that functioning has to be done in the most effective and efficient manner, and it has been found that it can be done provided the mind does not keep on interfering in every aspect psychologically. Now, this is exactly, if you are able to understand what is said by action without desire. If you want me to put it traditionally, which Krishnaji may not be happy with, but because he is not around us right now, I may take the liberty of using the term nishkama karma. Your action is not prompted by desire now.
That's right.
Your action is not oriented or driven by a desire towards a particular attainment of an objective. Your action is for the performance of action alone and nothing else. That is the sense in which we have to understand the statement karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. That is the deeper and inner meaning of it. See, the point is, unless we understand that the interference of the past, which is an acquisitive accumulation of desires and ideals and objectives, which are always causing a hindrance in the present in whatever I am doing, you will not be free of it. Now I am coming to the question of Venkatacharamji also. Sir, it is not about devoid of any knowledge. That would be a very wrong thing. See, the nature of the knowledge we have seen earlier as partial, as limited, and fragmented. We have discussed this earlier also. Please remember, any knowledge can only be partial. In fact, very, very partial. Even the worldly knowledge also. It has already been established by scientists and technologists who confirm that nobody's knowledge can be full or complete. However much there is to know, there is still much more that is unknown. So knowledge per se has these factors inbuilt into it. What are those factors? It is partial and it is limited by several factors, limited by your senses. You can't hear certain sounds. It's not because of those sounds are not there. It is because the instrument is only capable of certain range of catching the vibrations of sound. Similarly about sight. So your knowledge is not only partial, but it is also severely limited. And this knowledge also is not in a position to see things in totality. It can only understand in bits and pieces and in a fragmentary manner. So the question of completely blank, including understanding, communicating, is not the issue at all. The issue is not allowing the mind to interfere in the process of your observation. If you are observing something with awareness completely, your mind will automatically become to a great extent silent. But the moment you bring the mind into the picture, there is a disturbance, there is an interference, there is a fluctuation in your attention. Krishnamurti used to give a very simple example. Suppose you are climbing a hill and you are just almost near the top. The next step you take, you are at the top and you see on the other side a beautiful valley of flowers, a riot of colors, something of, you know, unimaginable beauty. When you accost that beauty with your senses, that exact moment when you see it, he says, what that condition is, where you and that valley of beauty are in oneness. There is no interference of the mind. You have suddenly come across and seen something tremendously beautiful. You are one with that beauty at that moment, at that fraction of a second, let us assume. The moment you say ah or wow, it is lost. This ah or wow is a response from your past mind. Do you see the beauty of it? He is talking about that oneness. The question now is, can that oneness be sustained without the interference of that mind, which is very ready to say, wow? He's talking about that oneness, that awareness of what is.
So that is also, sir, my question also is, if I don't have anything in my mind, then I can sustain.
No, don't talk about sustenance, sir. Sustenance is a response from the past. You are wanting to sustain. See, you have to be very, very subtle.
Okay, I will put it this way. Every moment I want to be in the present.
Right.
Not any interference.
No, don't want to be in the present. The question of want is a desire.
Or experience.
So
every
you are acutely aware of the present, that's all.
Okay, so for that, I should not have anything in my mind.
No, don't say should not. Should not, again, you are creating an ideal. Should not is a projection of the mind which says, okay, I should not have this. The moment you get this idea of should not, you are already falling into the trap of the mind. It is so subtle.
Okay.
Don't say anything. The moment you utter a word, the moment you verbalize it, it is lost. You understand the beauty?
Yeah, correct. But yeah. As long as I have that, that's why I said with
So understanding and communication and all those other things are all responses of the mind, reactions of the mind, sir. What I'm trying to say is don't try to understand or analyze in the way you are putting it. The way you are putting it appears as though that one has to be blank and there should not be any understanding, there should not be any communicating, there should not be anything. But why do you think in that way? Why cannot it be a better understanding or a better communication or a better state than blank?
The moment I bring in that better.
No, what I'm saying is I'm not comparing it. Can it be a different kind of understanding? Can it be a different kind of communication? Can it be something which is not blank, but it could be full also?
I don't know. Maybe it leads to perception ultimately.
Whatever it leads to is a different aspect, sir. Sir, what I am trying to again point out very humbly to you is, kindly don't verbalize it.
Sure.
The moment you verbalize it, it is lost. If you remember in wisdom, I told you in a very humorous manner that one fellow is anyway forced to speak. Whether there or here in this webinar, some idiot called Krishnapani is sitting here and talking nonsense. Let only one fellow talk that nonsense. You are all wise people. The moment you also come into my dimension, we will only be talking. That is my whole problem. You see the problem?
Yeah.
See, I am forced to verbalize. And earlier, Krishnaji was also forced to verbalize. The necessity for verbalization is that is the only means of communication available to us. But if all of us verbalize only, then that verbalization becomes something which is totally unnecessary and taking us away from the reality of things.
Okay.
What I request you is, if you are able to see the subtlety of what Krishnaji is talking about, then there is the possibility of coming to it without words, without thoughts.
Okay.
That's what I'm trying to say. Nothing beyond that.
Okay. Thank you.
So that's the moment we verbalize, what happens is the flavor, the fragrance of it is lost.
Yeah.
The subtlety of it is lost.
Okay.
We are trying to minimize the words and only trying to elaborate on a certain dimension of perception. He has verbalized it to the maximum extent possible and left it at that. Krishnaji throughout his life has done that and left it at that. So we have to see the nature of the whole thing that is happening to us. And to continue, what Krishnaji says is, so mind has divided life into ideals, purposes, culminations, attainments, ends, and turmoil, conflict, disturbance, disharmony, and you, yourself, the self-consciousness. This is a very, very, very important aspect of it, which I have marked, because he is actually dividing it into, three divisions, or he's talking about three divisions. One division is what he calls as ideals, purposes, culminations, attainments, ends. This is one division. Turmoil, conflict, disturbance, disharmony is another division. And you yourself, the self-consciousness, as the third division. So you see the problem now? The problem is, we have divided life into three aspects, or three divisions have been made. One division is me, I myself is one division. My desires, my ideals, my purposes, my attainments, my ends, my goals is another division. I have created another division where I want to reach that. This I, the division called I, has created another division and put it out there as my ends and objectives and goals and attainments and ideals and purposes and so on. Now, this I, in the process of trying to reach that, is involved in turmoil, conflict, disturbance, and disharmony. This is the third aspect. So he says, the mind has separated life into these three divisions. One division is the me. The other division is the goal. The third division is the turmoil and conflict in the process of my trying to reach that goal. The very inquiry into the purpose of life, the very inquiry into the purpose of life indicates the lack of intelligence in the present. When I am happy with myself in the condition in which I am as it is, why would I inquire into the purpose of life at all? The wanting of something indicates the lack of it, isn't it? When do I want something when I don't have it? So, because I don't have a purpose of life, I'm inquiring into it. That itself shows a lack of intelligence. Intelligence for our purpose, for this particular discussion, I have defined it as that acute awareness of what is without the interference of the mind, which is a repository of the past, right? So that intelligence being not there in the present is what is causing us to search for a purpose, is what is causing my search for the purpose of life. So a person who is fully active, not involved in activities, fully active is different from a person involved in activities. A person involved in activities is somebody who is into some kind of mundane thing, he has achieved something. But a person who is fully active, intelligently and emotionally and fully alive, he has already fulfilled himself. He's already fulfilled himself. There is nothing much to aspire for such a person. Therefore, the inquiry into an end is futile. Any inquiry into the end of certain things, he says, is futile. Because there is no such thing as an end and a beginning. There is but the continual movement of creative thinking. He brings in this additional dimension of creative thinking. He says all creativity flows from that intelligence. And that intelligence is a continuous movement. In that movement, there is no end, there is no beginning. There is no inquiry also. Yesterday evening, if some of you were present have seen, I have talked about discontinuity. Discontinuity as the dominant factor in all three states of consciousness, whether it's waking or dream state or deep sleep state, discontinuity is the major factor. Discontinuity is on and off. It's on and off. You are sometimes attentive, sometimes not attentive. Sometimes you cease to be attentive, sometimes you cease. So this on and off business is the discontinuity. But whereas when you are talking about awareness, there is only awareness. And when I am talking about continual movement, it is not concerned with time as we understand. Continual does not mean from morning to evening. This continuity is not in the dimension of time at all. Not in the dimension of time at all in any way. It is there, that's all. In that situation, there is no past and future. So therefore, there is no time also. So it is that intelligence which is operating. But the moment you fix some ideals, some purpose, some end, you are now trying to look at a perfect means of evasion. You want to arrive at that perfect evasion which you call ideals. The creation of an ideal according to Krishnaji is but an escape from the present turmoil. You are evading it because the present is not very happy, very desirable, or it's not giving you that which you are seeking. You are trying to avoid it. Whether the present is happy or there is struggle or conflict or turmoil, whatever it is important to be with that with full awareness. In that full awareness, that intelligence will operate and there will be a dissolution of your conflict, your struggle once for all. Because you have now seen the nature of conflict, the very root of conflict, the very origin of that conflict, where it has come from and why it is causing trouble is totally clear to you. The moment it is clear, there is no conflict now. Therefore, very rarely, because this was in 1934, Krishnaji very rarely talks about his own state of being. And those of you who have got this PowerPoint presentation which was sent this morning, I have put this particular sentence in bold, italics, and in blue color. The regular text is in yellow, but this particular statement I have put it in blue. You can go back and refer to it also. Why I say it is very, very important is, here Krishnaji reveals inadvertently his own state. And he says, now to me, the turmoil, the end, and the you are the same. There is no division. In his state of consciousness, in his state of being, this division into three, the end, the turmoil, and the you are all one and the same. The three divisions which we have talked about are not there, he says, for me. Me in the sense, Krishnaji himself is referring to himself and says, now to me, the turmoil, the end, and the division, and you are the same. There is no division. This division is artificial and it is created by the desire to gain, by the pursuit of acquisitive accumulation, which is born of insufficiency. I am feeling inadequate. I am feeling insufficient in my now. And instead of living with that insufficiency, inadequacy, insecurity, and trying to become acutely aware of it, I am only trying to escape from it. The moment I try to escape from it, the escape route is creating an ideal, creating a purpose, and moving towards that purpose. And the movement itself is a struggle. The attainment of an ideal is a great turmoil and great conflict and great matter of struggle for me. Because these three divisions are there. The I, the end, and the turmoil. For Krishnaji, he says, now to me, the turmoil, the end, and the you are the same. There is no division. Why does this division arise? This division, he says, is an artificial division which is created by the desire to gain an objective. Why do you want to attain an objective? Because you are insufficient. So this is what it is. And what is the nature of this I? We have to understand the nature of this I. The nature of this I, he says, this I is but a long continuous scroll of memory in which there are accentuations. It's a long scroll of memory. The I is nothing but that. This is not a point to debate. This is a point to contemplate and see whether it is true or not. And there are accentuations. These accentuations, this sometimes you are in elation, sometimes you are in depression, some events put you somewhere up there, some events put you down into the dumps. So what happens is, these accentuations, he calls it as complexes. These are complexes in one's nature. And when the mind or the memory is unable to comprehend, the lack of this comprehension creates the memory. When you have experienced something and ended it there, there is no recording, there is no memory in that. The moment you are unable to comprehend, you will store it in memory and say, let me examine, let me think about it, let me come to it with more experience and more knowledge. Because it is insufficient. So this memory is the one which is acting or guiding you towards that end. The moment the memory comes into picture, you have already pre-established or predetermined the end. You want this particular end. You want a particular end. That means sitting here in the present, you are deciding what you want in the future psychologically. This is nothing but the self-protective mechanism. You are seeking refuge in the self-protective mechanism. And this ideal or what you want to achieve, whether you call it as truth or God or perfection, it doesn't matter. Because you have already predetermined that I want to attain God. But when you don't have any comprehension of what God is, or the mind can never have any comprehension of what God is, isn't it foolish to determine that as the end and move towards it? That's where the problem comes. Therefore, he says, I say there is only wisdom, which is understanding, not protection. Your security, self-protection, and all these things, they are the outcome of insufficiency. You can find out the cause for that insufficiency through awareness. That is what we need to do. You can find out the cause of insufficiency through awareness, and he adds on and says, now to be aware is not to alter. To be aware does not mean that you alter the situation or you want to change it. You are with what is as it is. If you are aware, you will discover the full significance of the environment. You will now understand fully what is the significance of the environment, the temperament, the inheritance, the you, the turmoil, and the end. All these things, the significance of all these things becomes very clear, and we will discover the full significance of it. And only when all these walls of protection are destroyed in the flame of awareness, in which there is no modification or alteration or adjustment, but complete understanding of the significance of environment with all its delicacies and subtleties, only through that understanding is there the eternal. I am not going to elaborate much on this particular last paragraph. I request those of you who have received this presentation to please read the last two slides very carefully, because any amount of explanation on my part is only going to create more verbalization and more complexity. I would just read it and leave it at that, because we have already exceeded the time also. I'll just read that paragraph and leave it at that for your understanding. you can go back, read it again and again, and try to imbibe what Krishna ji is saying. Only when all these walls of protection are destroyed in the flame of awareness, in which there is no modification or alteration or adjustment, but complete understanding of the significance of environment with all its delicacies and subtleties, only through that understanding is there the eternal. Because in that there is no you functioning as a self-protective focus. But as long as that self-protecting focus, which you call the I, exists, there must be confusion, there must be disturbance, disharmony and conflict. You cannot destroy these hindrances by disciplining yourself or by following a system or by imitating a pattern. You can understand them with all their complications only through the full awareness of mind and heart. Then there is an ecstasy, there is that living movement of truth, which is not an end, not a culmination, but an ever creative living, an ecstasy which cannot be described because all description must destroy it. So long as you are not vulnerable to truth, there is no ecstasy, there is no immortality. Thank you. Do we have some time to take questions?
Sure, yes.
Sanaji, I have taken your point. What you said is correct. Earlier, we used to follow the pattern of answering questions at the end. But I wanted to make certain things clear in between before we proceed further, and therefore I stopped to answer one or two questions. Any further questions, please?
Questions, anyone?
Most welcome. If there is, now you remember our school days or college days, when the teacher or lecturer used to say, if there are no questions, there are only two conditions: either you have fully understood it or have not understood anything.
So, oh, I have a question, Krishnaji.
Yeah.
You know, for a young man who's just starting out in life,
yeah,
he needs some kind of ambition in order to provide for his family in the future.
Right.
All those things are his primary goal.
Yeah.
How does what you said sync with what I said?
Vijayji, Krishnamurti is not talking about that. Krishnamurti is not talking about the need for action in this world. Okay. The need for action nobody can deny. Your existence, your livelihood, you are being healthy, you are being happy. Nobody is denying this. The only point that is being questioned is that are you caught in the web of desires which creates turmoil in you?
A young man is actually caught in that web of desire.
Yes, yes. And that's why he is stressed. He is terribly stressed. And there is terrible amount of dissatisfaction.
Yes.
See, if I am intelligent enough, I should know what I am capable of doing. But unfortunately, the world outside has created a situation where they have made it to be something very ordinary to keep desiring for things without deserving it. Mm-hmm. I am capable of doing a certain kind of work. That certain work has a certain value in society.
Yes.
No, I can't do the job which the society values as 100 rupees and at the same time desire that the society should pay me 1,000 rupees. The society has put a certain value on my work, isn't it?
Yes.
Why did it put it? Because there are so many like me who can do that job.
It's a market value.
So if I have to aspire that the society should pay me 1,000 rupees, I should upgrade myself to a skill which is valued by the society at 1,000. But without doing that, if I get caught in this web of desires, see, you your income, your situation, your position, you are capable of, say, buying a mobile phone of 100,000 rupees. My position is such that I can afford only a 5,000 or a 10,000 rupees phone. Now, should I aspire to get that 1 lakh rupees phone without the means for it and blame the society for its unfairness and say that it has given to you and not given to me when I am not contributing anything to the society? So that is there, that is never disputed. So you have a certain skill set and you market your skill set and you get the reward or remuneration for it, which the society determines. It's a question of demand and supply, isn't it? I can't be doing the job of a sweeper and thinking of the salary of Sundar Pichai. So then the conflict comes. So then the turmoil comes. I have fixed the ideal now. I am a sweeper. My ideal is to become Sundar Pichai. I have no skills. I have not upgraded myself. I have not studied in the college or university or where we have studied, or I did not do the work, he did it. So when I keep that kind of disparity, there is always a continuous turmoil and a continuous struggle. It's going on, and there we are caught in.
So the people who have succeeded in life, I mean, succeeded meaning like a Bill Gates or even a
Sundar. No problem, no issues at all.
They all dreamt very big, and they had ambitions.
That ambition was, they knew the direction in which they are moving and they made it a reality. The trouble comes when you evade the reality and talk in terms of something else.
Then you're under stress.
Then there is a trouble. That's the conflict.
That is the frustration.
Yeah, if you understand the reality, if you understand, see, I if I understand from that, I cannot focus my potential. So that stupidity should dawn on me at some point of the time and say, this is not for me. But I can't evade it and say, if I pray to God, I will become a mathematician. Will be a foolish thing, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Then the turmoil, the struggle, the conflict, everything begins there. So what is includes what you are essentially, fundamentally what you are, what are your capabilities, what are your weaknesses, what are your strengths, what are, and early point of view, you can hone your skills or you can acquire skills to create value in the society. Because in isolation, you can't create value, isn't it? That is important. So nobody disputes any of these things. The dispute is the psychological burden which we carry by unrealistic desires or unrealistic objectives, unrealistic ideals, and placing ourselves in a situation where we are always trying to avoid the present. Okay. Yes, sir. Any more questions?
I think it was very, very clearly. So we'll go with the first part of what you said. When you're taught something, if there are no questions, then there are only two logical responses to that. One is when it's actually understood. So I think that's where we are.
And I think Dr. Sana has put it rightly. He says, let us not gain immediate gratification through words. That is precisely what I want to say. As per JK, it is pure intelligence with awareness of what is without clouded by the mind. We do not need specialists to decipher what is exactly. You are right. We don't need a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a counselor or somebody else to decipher what is for us, because what is for us has to be understood in totality by oneself through one's own endeavor and intelligence. And you are absolutely right, Sanaji. I think I should thank you for succinctly summarizing it. And I understand that you have honed the skill of summarizing through association with Ma Manijay.
Yeah, very much true. Very much true.
Yeah, yeah. Good.
I always find her in my mind and makes me do this job. Thank you.
I would like, as I said at the just before ending, I would like you to go through the last two slides of my presentation, which I prepared carefully, and you know, contemplate on it, and let the truth sink in of what he's saying. We should be, therefore, that is what is required: being vulnerable to truth, being capable of receiving whatever comes through that truth without any choice. That's what he used to call as choiceless awareness.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much
again for taking time out and, you know, making the presentation to us, talking to us, and, you know, deciphering in a sense J. Krishnamurti, who's very difficult to understand. Thank you so much for that. I just wanted to inform everybody that next week we have three programs, and program that we do on J. Krishnamurti will be shifted to Sunday, the same time. So 11:30 Sunday 17th, we will have this program. And on this Saturday 16th, we have Andrew Cohen talking to us at 11 o'clock. And the other thing that I wanted to also remind you was that we have our Thursday Satsang, Spiral of Wisdom, on 14th May. And next week, we have our own Satsangi, Fatima Zaveri, speaking to us on mind, body, and soul. So please note these three dates and timings. We will post all the information on it very shortly. So you will have that as ready reckoner and ready reference for you. So thank you so much, everybody, for being here. And we can close with Loka Samastha. Sajani? Sajani?
She is there.
She's there.
I don't know whether she has heard you or not. I don't know.
Sajani? I don't know. Maybe she's... okay.
Maybe.
Yeah.
You can recite it yourself, or Meena ji can recite.
Meena, can we request you to do Loka Samastha?
Loka Samastha Sukhino Bhavantu. Loka Samastha Sukhino Bhavantu. Loka Samastha Sukhino Bhavantu. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Meena ji and Dr. Sana ji. And we'll see you again next Thursday. Don't forget the programs that we have on Saturday and Sunday also next week. Thank you all for being here. Thank you.
Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.